Before getting into the subject today, just a 1 minute discussion is, we have to understand two things that, one side language, one side we have language, the other side we have theory. Is this seen by everyone?
Yes.
Okay. So guys, here we are discussing, assuming that the prerequisite, we are assuming theory is there with everyone. Theory is known to everyone. This is switching theory and logic design. This theory I am assuming is there with everyone. With that assumption, now what we are going to do is, we are going to learn this language. This language is hardware description language. The known theory we use, and with the help of this HDL language, we code it. We code the behavior of this theory. Now it is the job of the software tool to give us hardware. So guys, no one should have understanding that we are going to teach STLD. We are not going to teach here STLD. If you have any queries, personally ping me. I will arrange separate classes for them, for STLD. And we are trying to understand the language. We are going to learn the language and the known theory. We are going to translate into the HDL language. With the help of softwares, we are trying to open the hardware. This should be clear before learning this session, our class. With this said, let us go to this slides. So as you see here from the slides here, this is a hardware description language. HDL stands for hardware description language. So the functionality here, this functionality, we code using textual format sort of thing. The functionality of digital systems. Functionality of digital systems in a textual format we code. So that resembles programming language. Anyone will have first impression will be the sort of C or C++, like that. Impression will be there, programming language impression. But we have to understand this, how this is different from the programming language that we'll see in subsequent slides. The main difference with the other high level language is, this is high level language, this C++. HDLs, that is hardware description languages, constructs means keywords. The keywords that are there in the language, so these are keywords. Those keywords that are there in the language are compiler, that is how it is working. So that constructs ability to perform parallel execution, this parallel behavior. For example, let me clear this. For example, if I have something, some sort of thing, A equal to B, and B equal to A. So if you take this one, the other way, if you take A less than or equal to B and B less than or equal to A. In this first case, what happens is we have two statements here. This is the statement A, let us say this is the statement B. First statement A should get executed. Statement A should get executed. Then only statement B execution is possible with the help of this sort of constructs. There are other sort of constructs for assignment itself. I'm telling this about constructs. So these constructs, if you use this, seem to be a less than or equal to B. But in a context, in some context, we'll see that later on. These are assignment operators. The way this is assignment operator, this less than or equal to is also an assignment operator. But in this case, what happens is this old value of A and B are red. Old value of A and B are red. Let us say A is 3 and B is 2. Let us say like that. In this case, what happens? First case, this B value 2 is assigned here. A has got now value 2. Now these 2 here again been assigned to B. So what is that B getting the value here in this first case? It is getting its own value, previous value itself. But if you take the second example, this example, the old values are red and kept in the memory, meaning B2 is red, is kept in the memory. A being red, that is 3, kept in the memory. Now A will get an assignment of 2 and 3 is assigned to B. This is possible with the help of this sort of constructs, assignment operators. So that is what called parallelism behavior. That is what called parallel execution. So that is possible in this language only, this HDL language. So, but whereas in high level languages such as C, C++, and or any other high language, sequential execution, one after another. First statement one, execution should be done, then only it will come to the statement two, and then only it will come to the statement three. So this is called sequential behavior. If execution needs to happen like 1, 2, 3 at a given time, let us say t equal to t itself, it should happen. This assignment should happen. So this is not possible in any other high level language. You take your C, that is only possible in a hardware description languages. That is the first important difference between this HDLs and high level languages. So unlike sequential execution nature of other language constructs, that is the same point is elaborated here. This parallel execution is there in the HDLs, and whereas in a high level languages, sequential execution nature is there. That is the point. So guys, that is the main difference. Now coming to, we have two types of HDLs. This Verilog HDL is one language and VHDL is another language. Kindly never acronym or you make a short form of Verilog HDL as a VHDL. Never you try this. Don't try this. Because there is another language, VHDL, very high speed integrated circuit hardware description language. This language is different and this Verilog HDL is different. That's why you should not acronym Verilog HDL as a VHDL. So most widely used are these two HDLs across the countries. And there is another language here that has come, that is called system. Somebody kindly mute. There is another language called system Verilog. Can someone use that? I have to remove or what? So there is another language. Just a moment, guys. Let me trace the person. I request everyone kindly mute. If you have doubts, you can unmute and talk. We have to maintain the decorum of the ongoing session.
Sir, I'm not able to see your video.
You are not able to see my video?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Now you cannot see. Earlier I was presenting, no? At that time?
At that time also I can't see.
What about others?
Yeah, I could see.
Okay.
I could see.
Okay. Those who are not able to see, what you have to do is, you have in your Google Meet, people and chat. There are two tabs. Would you be able to locate? Chandru Sekhar?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
There people, under people tab, you have to see, you will be seeing two names, Zakir Hussain, and the other is the Zakir Hussain presentation. Are you able to locate?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Now you have to pin Zakir Hussain presentation, that you have to pin. To see my presentation on your screen, you have to pin that one. Pin means simply touch that name. Is that okay? Chandru Sekhar?
Yep. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. No, I'm able to.
Oh. Okay. Okay. Kindly, if you have doubts, you can unmute. Otherwise, kindly be muted. Yeah, Chandru Sekhar, okay. you have doubts?
No, no, sir. Thanks.
Okay. Okay. Okay, guys. This one. I hope everyone able to see. Are you able to see this one?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So, guys, I was telling that apart from these two languages, we have another language called System Verilog. But as I was yesterday telling, that this System Verilog has been divided into two. One is for design, the other is for verification. Verification. This is completely, totally different. Verification constructs are different. Constructs means this language, somewhere it has come. Just a moment. Somewhere the word constructs on this one. This one I'm telling. Constructs are keywords. Keywords are different. System Verilog verification constructs are different. System Verilog design constructs are different. But those who are going for System Verilog, they must be knowing Verilog SDL, then it will be a lot easier for them to understand System Verilog. So anyway, you have to take this course. So that's the point here. Let us proceed. We have to understand few things before dealing with the language. So language is a free format language. That is the point number one. Meaning I can write program like a module, and the module name some ABC. And here I'm putting port list and semicolon. In this very line, I can write my input like that. I don't need to come to the next line to write. I don't need to come to the again next line to write anything. And then end module like that. I can put everything in the one line. It's a free format language. White space can be used freely. Anywhere you can have some space here. So that is allowed. Verilog is a case sensitive. This is important. This is very, very important. Case sensitive, meaning, just a moment, let me clear this. You have something, your declaration input, your A comma B comma C, and your output. You have uppercase S, and then lowercase UM, sum. Uppercase C and lowercase O, and in the assignment somewhere you are using all lowercase. So all lowercase. So this is totally different. This sum is different and this sum is different. And this C O uppercase and lowercase is different and this is different. That is what this case sensitive means. So be careful whatever the variable you are giving. Ensure that is followed throughout your description. So that is the point here about the case sensitivity. Just very quickly, we have to wrap this theory portion because we have to see the practicals. identifiers. This identifier is important, guys. An identifier is used as an object reference. As an object reference, an identifier can contain a sequence of letters, digits, underscores, and dollar signs. These are allowed. 1, 2, 3, 4. Only these are allowed. The rule is, first character of an identifier can only be a letter or an underscore. That is the rule. Like you can have your sum, that is allowed. You can have some dollar, that is also allowed. You can have some underscore sum, that is also allowed. These three are allowed. You cannot have one and then sum. You are starting with a numerical value. That is not allowed. And you are starting with a dollar sum. It is not allowed. So the rules for having an identifier, your identifier, user defined identifier, first character has to be a letter. First character has to be a letter or an underscore, this underscore. So that is important. Two important points here. One is a case sensitive, and this is another important point, that it shouldn't be beginning with a dollar or a numerical value. So you can start with the underscore or a alphabet. So now keywords. Let us move to the keywords. These are predefined identifiers to define the language constructs. Suppose say you have if, this is a keyword. You have module, this is a keyword. So all such keywords we'll learn through practice. So all keywords are defined in lowercase. This is again important point. You cannot have module like that, because that is a keyword. This is a module is a keyword. So that should be lowercase only. But you can have some like that, some and CO, because these are user-defined identifiers. User-defined identifiers in your own ways you can have, except that it shouldn't begin with a dollar and it shouldn't begin with a numerical value. Following these rules you can have in your own ways. But all keywords, remember, they are with the lowercase only. So cannot be used as identifier. This is another point. Like you are having a keyword input, and then you are using something like identifier for your purpose. If you cannot use this, if is a keyword, language keyword, as a user defined identifier you cannot use it. So that is the point here to understand about the keywords, nothing more. Now this is a very important comments. How to have a good core developer should have comments. So single line comments and multiple line comments are there here. So if you see this forward slash and asterisk, and this asterisk and then forward slash. So these are multiple line comments. In a language, to have multiple line comments, what is the procedure? This is the forward slash, asterisk, and write anything. And where you want to end there, asterisk, and then this forward slash. These are multiple line comments. Single line comments, two forward slash. Single line comments. And coming to the strings, there is no separate data type for that. What data type and all we'll see. But the strings are enclosed here like in double quotes, here, like this double quotes. And just a moment, let me clear this. Each string is assigned with a ASCII value, 8-bit character. Suppose if I want to assign, let us say, cat. So for this 8 bits, right, in ASCII, that is some ASCII value, ASCII. So we have eight bits for that, for this eight bits, meaning how many bits are required to hold that cat? 3 × 8, so total we need 24. So we have to have a vector definition with a 24, 23:0, this is a vector A, let us say A. Now this A can hold this cat, like that I have to assign. Cat is assigned to A now. Is that clear to everyone? What is this strings about? So coming to this escape the characters, you can have backslash and then escape character for new line, tab, like that. We'll see that during the test bench development or core development there, we'll see. So let us go to the next. Here in this language, we have something called system tasks and something called system function. System tasks will begin with a dollar sign. System tasks. And even system functions will begin with a dollar. For example, in a system task, you take a dollar monitor. And here in this system function, dollar time. Then what is the difference between system task and system function? System task will not return any value. It will not return any value. It will return value. What will return value? System function will return value. System task will not return any value. So for example, in this case, if dollar time is used, simulation time is returned to the console. You are running a simulation from 0 to 100 nanoseconds. At every 10 seconds, something is happening. That something happening, you want to see in the console. The time at 10, at 20, at 30, at 40. What is that happening? The time to be printed. And you want to see that anything here. So what is that we have to see here? This dollar time if used, this dollar time will return the simulation time. Dollar monitor will not return anything. What has been ordered to print, that print we will see. So that, again, those who are not comfort with this, what is that system task will not return. What is that dollar time will return? Practically, I will demonstrate. Don't go panic. But at this point, what you have to understand is, system tasks and system functions, both will begin with a dollar sign. Both will begin with a dollar sign. That is one thing that you have to understand at this stage. And the second point that you have to understand is, system tasks will not return any value. System function will return value. These two points at this stage you have to remember. Later we will see practically the usage of this. Now coming to the compiler directive, anywhere we have backcode define and a backcode time, and there are many several. For example, I just took this backcode define and backcode time. Anything that starts the way dollar with dollar sign, anything that starts with a dollar, what it is? It is a system task. It would be system function. Similarly, anywhere if you see anything that is starting with a backcode, then whatever that is, then that is called this one, compiler directive. So anywhere if you see anything that is started with a backcode. You see the backcode here. Backcode include. For example, you have this is a simulation starting with a starting from zero and going up to T time units. These time units may be anything from femtoseconds, microseconds, milliseconds, nanoseconds and microseconds and milliseconds and seconds. So it could be anything. This time unit could be femtosecond, nanosecond, microsecond, millisecond or second. Allowed time units are this. Now I want here to see this scale. This you see this one. This is the scale. Let us say this is a scale. and this scale should be in a nanoseconds. So if you don't tell the compiler, by default, whatever the compiler, some compilers will put the scale as a femtosecond. Some compilers will put a nanosecond, some compiler microsecond. But you want in a specific time unit, let us say that specific time unit is a nanosecond. And also you want some precision in the time, this various time here. Some precision in the time, meaning 5.432. After decimal point, 3 digits precision you want. 1, 2, 3. So this precision, you have to tell the compiler after decimal point, maintain this precision, 3-digit precision. So that is done through a compiler directive called backcode time scale. Backcode time scale. Space, here time unit slash forward slash time precision, TP, time unit forward slash time precision. For example, just let me clear all this. Backcode time scale 1 nanosecond slash 1 picosecond. If I convert this 1 picosecond to the nanosecond, it would be 0.01 nanosecond. Meaning here the time unit is in nanosecond and time precision is after decimal point. This after decimal point, we are telling the compiler to have 3 decimal digits. So meaning what? Now anywhere if I am having this is a delay control operator. Hash is a delay control operator. Now I am going to have here 12.9179 something like that in my simulation. So I'm telling the compiler that treat this as a scale, entire scale as a nanosecond. So here 1 nanosecond, I mean this scale is in nanoseconds, multiply this one with this time here, that is 12 nanoseconds. Point, what is the after decimal point, how many digits I am asking compiler to be maintained? 3 only. So what it does, it rounds here, this is a 9, right? This rounds to the higher value, that is 8. So 12.918 nanoseconds. So like that. So this is instructed with the help of backcode time scale. This is a compiler directive. Several other compiler directives are there, backcode define, backcode include. All this we will see in subsequent classes. The usage of this we will see in subsequent classes. Now, we have integer numbers. How do we represent integer numbers? We can represent a number, sized numbers or unsized integers. In size number representation, we have format called size, and this is a tick, and this is the base and value. For example, 14 is there. 14, for us, it is a decimal number system, for us. So, but if I want to represent this one in a binary, so what is the required binary for this? 1110, right? So now I have to tell the compiler that this 14, how many bits are required in a binary? 4, right? So 4 bits to represent a number, and that number is in a binary format, and the number is 110. Like that, I have to tell to the compiler. And let us say I want to have it in a hexadecimal format, hexadecimal. So 4 tick H, and this one is, what is that? A, B, C, D, E, F, right? This is E. So E. Lowercase, uppercase allowed here. This B could be uppercase also. 4 tick B, 1110. This is allowed. Lowercase is also allowed. Here also same case. 4 tick. We can have H, capital, and even this is allowed lower or uppercase. This way also allowed. This way also allowed. So what is the advantage then? Why not directly unsigned integer like this? So advantage is this. Just a moment, let me clear. If you have your OS operating system, 32 bit or 64. Nowadays, most of the people are having 64 bit OS operating system. And over the top of this operating system, you are installing your compiler. Which compiler? Your Verilog HDL compiler. You are installing over the top of the OS operating system. Suppose you are installing it on 32, what happens then? If you are using to assign to the A 14 value, 14, whatever ultimately inside the binary, it is inside the compiler, it is binary only. It is going to be a 1 and 0 format. So 1, 1, 1, 0, these 4 bits. And left out 28 bits will be filled with all zeros. All zeros. This is happening. This is going to happen inside the Verilog HDL compiler. Just to represent 14, how many it is using? 32 bits. If operating system, usage of operating system is happens to be 32 bit operating system. If you are using a 64-bit operating system, then it is going to use how many? Total 64 bits it is going to use. A few more zeros here, this side. 64. So that it can make up to, total can make to 64. Which is not a good. Why? Because during simulation, even this matters. Simulation time. Simulation should be fast enough. Our simulation, whatever the code that we have written, that code, whether working or not, functional simulation should not take months or weeks or some days. It should be as quickly possible, it should finish the functional simulation. So if this is going to happen for every identifier, this 64-bit, nowadays nobody using 32-bit, majority are using 64. And if it is assigning, I mean, it is taking like that, in the simulation point of view I'm talking, then what happens is simulation time will increase. So in order to avoid this, to the compiler what we instruct is, don't use straight away this 14, meaning don't use straight away 32-bit or 64-bit on whichever compiler you are, Verilog HDL compiler. You please use only 4 bits, 4 tick B, 1110. Now you use this for A. That is what we are telling to the compiler. Now compiler, what it does, it concentrates only on the usage of these 4 bits and it will not be using unnecessary zeros like that. Thereby what happens is simulation time we are going to minimize. For our small examples, half adder, full adder, it may not be affecting. But in industry where 10,000 or 15,000 like that lines statements are there, there definitely it is going to matter. So that's why this usage is beneficial in simulation point of view. So simulation point of view, it is okay. Now we'll see this further usage. At this point, we'll move to the other. Real numbers is possible. Here we can represent such numbers also. In scientific notation also we can represent. We'll see everything in practically with examples. We'll move to the important points. This value set, Verilog supports total 4 value sets. This is important. Understanding this point is how many it supports? 4. One is 0, the other is 1, the other is X, that is unknown, the other is high impedance state. So remember guys, this is going to support either of these 4 here available. So let us move on to this. This is again important, data types. We have two types of data types in the Wheatland SDF. So just a moment, let me clear. As you see here, net data types and register data type, registers. But these registers data types, this term is used in 1995, when first time language is publicly in public domain. It has come when it has become IEEE standards. At that time, registers was the data type. But this language has took several amendments. In the 2001, some amendments took place. In the 2005, some amendments took place. In the 2010, some amendments took place. In 2012, some amendments took place. Till here, they considered it as a Verilog only. Verilog. But the moment when in the 2012 or 2013 somewhere, where major changes took place, they did not prefer calling it as a Verilog HDL. They preferred it as a system Verilog HDL, because several major changes took place at that time. Major. So they called totally it as a system Verilog HDL. This comprises of two, as I said earlier, yesterday also I said, system Verilog for design, system Verilog for verification. So like that, major changes took place in this year. So now the point is what I'm telling here. In 1995, register data type was there, but later on they changed it to variable data type. Variable data. So we must be familiar with these two terms. Data types in the Verilog HDL are two types. One is a net data type, the other is a variable data type. If you are coming across in some of the books, old print books, then you will see register data types. There shouldn't be any confusion. Register data type, nothing but variable only. They renamed it in the 2001 like a variable data type. So let me clear this. So now finally, before getting into these data types, what we have to understand is why actually data types are required. So now there is a water and there are stones and there are some other material. So definitely this water I may have in a glass or a bucket. Okay, so I cannot have stones in glass or I cannot have in a bucket. For that, different material is required to hold that one. Different container is required. So these are the containers. Data types are the containers. So to hold some sort of data, data is this water, stones. These are the data. To hold this data, what is required? Container is required. This container is nothing but this types. This to hold the data, we have the types. These are the types here. These containers are the types. So these types are net and variable data. But nothing much. Don't panic about the new learners especially. So, for example, you have this this one. Half adder. Let us take example of a half adder. You have primary inputs and primary output. This is your A, this is your B, this is your sum, this is your carry out. Now you are trying to describe this one. You have to describe this one. Meaning this is your data, right? This is your data, like water and the stone. This is your data. So how do you put in a description here? How do you describe? You need a container. What type of container is required for that? So possibly input is a container, that is type data, and it's a type. Type means container, and in this container you put a and another type is a output. And in this, you put a data, that is your sum and carry out. And this is, but one case. The other case is you have some constructs, language constructs. For example, always is there. And in this always, you are going to assign to the sum and carry out to the sum something you are going to assign. Where you are assigning within the always. What is always and all, we'll see later on. Don't worry about that. This is straight away without always here. You are going to assign sum equal to A XOR with B. You are going to assign like that. But this is you are going to assign inside the always. At that time, this sum, you see the sum here, this is the type here. This sum, apart from having this output, it should also belong to a type container called reg. So in this register data type, we have several other subcategories. In this subcategory, one subcategory is this reg. So basically what I'm trying to convey here is this types here, containers to hold this data variables. We need something to hold them. This to hold them, we need something. That is data type. So depending upon where you are assigning to these variables, you are assigning here outside of the always, then some other data type. Within always, you are assigning some other data type are required. So that's it. We'll see elaboratively. Don't worry. Don't go panic. So now, this apart from this, what the description examples I have given, these data types are to connect here. One block to this is one block, and this is another block. You want to connect with it. So this is this sort of mechanism. This sort of container here, which is helping us to connect from this block to that block, is also a net type. Is also a net type. But something you want to hold, so suppose say for example, you have a previous value you have assigned to the JK. When JK is 0, 0, you have assigned some to Q and a Q bar. When J comes 0. And K is becoming 1, you have to assign to the something. Meaning it should be aware. What should be aware? What is that I'm holding previous value? This Q1 should be aware. What is that previous value? Because a case will come J1, K1. Then what we say? Q is previous whatever is there, that is previous of that bar. That is what he said. Meaning previous bar means previous knowledge is required. Meaning that behavior which can imitate that behavior, holding behavior. Holding behavior means that is not there in the net data type. That holding behavior comes in the register data type. I said earlier, this register data type is also called variable data type. Never ever confuse. Interchangeably we can use register data type or variable data type. These variable data type, they help us to hold the value during our description of the hardware. During description of our hardware, in case we want to hold, for example, one more example, Q is Q plus 1. Whenever there is a positive edge of the clock is occurring, and positive edge of the clock is coming here, CLK clock, then it is happening. Let us say Q is incremented. Q is incremented means previously if it is 3, it is 4. Previously if it is 2, then it is 3. Previously if it is 4, then it is 5. Meaning previous value knowledge is required, no? So previous value knowledge, we should be able to hold it. Who should be able to hold? The compiler should be able to hold. Compiler holds in the types, the containers. So that behavior comes in the register data types or variable data. It is not there in the net data type to hold that value. Net data type will the current data, whatever the current value. Suppose say this is your AND gate. The value of AND gate depends on the current value of this. Unlike this counter. Counter value, whether it is depending upon this, previously we don't know what it is. Previously, not necessarily this should be up counter means 1, 2, 3 like that. It can be like a 1 to 7. And then 7 to 9, that also a counter behavior only. This is a different counter. Meaning previously what it is, that behavior should be there in the counter. But what is their previous value here in the AND gate? That is not required to hold. To hold the value of y is not required. So such are net data type, and the holding variables are required to hold the variables in the description. Let us say q is a variable, it should hold the previous value. So they fall under the category of register data type. So that is about this lot more to discuss here. Actually, these are entirely list. If you see, this is net data type. In net data type alone, we have wire, this TRI keyword. These are the keywords. WOR, war, or trior. These are the keywords. Similarly, you can see WAND and TRY AND, TRY REG and TRY 1 and TRY 0 and SUPPLY 0 and SUPPLY 1. So you see here 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11. Total 11 keywords are there in the net data type. Keywords. So what is the how to use them and all, we will see in the next session, because we are running out of time, just 10 minutes left. So at this point, what just let me clear this. Anything in the Verilog GGL, if you don't declare, suppose say you are not declaring in your code module, if it's your module, something, your name and all, that everything will see later, don't go panic. You are assigning here, assign is the keyword, assign, and the sum equal to A and B. And you have assigned here, I mean declared here, input and say A comma B. But you did not declare sum, what it is, you did not declare. Then this is, as long this is a scalar type, as long that identifier is a scalar type. Scalar means single bit, one bit, right? So compiler, Verilog GGL compiler is going to treat this as a wire. This is going to treat it as a wire data type. Wire belongs to which data type? Under net data type, we have all this. Wire belongs to which data type means? It belongs to net data type. Try belongs to which data type means? Net data type. Like that, we have to understand it. There is no keyword net. I'm sorry. There is no keyword net, and there is no keyword register or variable. So, and the important point here is, by default, this net data type will have this Z as a default value. What is the default value of the net data types? Net data type means all these are the net data types. I counted now just now, total 11 keywords are there. So what is the default value of this? Default value of the net data type is this Z or Z, high impedance state. Default value, if you don't declare any other. And the default value of this registers is X, that is unknown. This we have to remember, very important, the default value of this. So that is the one point. And in this register data type, we'll see tomorrow about this entire data type, net data type and register data type. We have reg is a keyword, this reg, and integer is a keyword, and time is a keyword. And the real is another keyword, and real time is another keyword. You see how many? 1, 2, 3, 4, 1. You have to remember how many variable data types are there. Total 5 variable data types are there. Variable data types. Interchangeably, I am using variable data type or register data type, because I already made it clear that this is according to 1995. Register data type. But from 2001, this has become variable data type. The name changes, that's it, nothing more. So These are phi, you have to remember. Register data type are only phi, but in net data type, we have these many several. And the default value of net data type is V, and the default value of register data type is a X. So with that said, guys, I just conclude today's session because